Joining us, Sarah Nahal, it is Afternoon Edition. The fallout from the US election and the growing influence of right-wing politics is the inspiration behind singer-songwriter Tori Amos's new album. She's sold more than 15 million records around the world. As well as politics, her music explores environmental issues and all the complexities of love. Tori told me about the location and people who influenced her new album, Native Invader.
Well, I went to the Smoky Mountains, North Carolina and Tennessee, to really retrace my grandfather's stories, things he would tell me about when I was a little girl. And I did, hoping that it would inspire some songs. And it did, but it took a few months later and many different things, many different changes that were happening in the States and also in my private life with my mom, when the songs then started flooding in really. Early this year.
Yeah, in January, because two things happened that you describe as seismic events. Your mother, Mary, had a stroke, leaving her unable to speak, and Donald Trump was elected president.
Yes, it seemed as if the penny dropped for me as I was driving up to the hospital to see Mary every day, that Mary was and is under attack. So is America. And once that was shown to me, really, by the muses that I work with and have since I can remember, 2.5, then the song started joining forces in a way to try and help me understand what I was feeling personally with my mom and being in the States at the time, and also trying to hear what other people were going through. And so the songs themselves started to say, T, you've got to take a step back here, because you can't be in reaction mode. You need to create a place, sort of like a sonic secret garden.
Well, let's hear one of the tracks now from Native Invader. This has got Papa's influence, your granddad's influence, running right through it. This is Up the Creek.
Good Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. Good Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. Good Lord willing, and the creek don't rise.
Up the Creek from Native Invader. Papa was a Cherokee, Calvin Clinton Copeland.
Yes, he was part Eastern Cherokee Nation and part European. And he was such an influence on my life. He died when I was 9.5. And I just remember lying next to his gravestone in North Carolina because I couldn't hear the stories anymore. And I couldn't remember them. Just couldn't remember them for several years. And then all of a sudden, they started to come back, almost in his voice with his rhythm of speaking. And I guess that is something that I carry with me every day, is his love and his love of storytelling.
What did Papa's spirituality give you growing up, Tori, that you couldn't get from the Christian home that you came from? Your father is, of course, a reverend.
He believed in walking the walk. And he would warn me. He would say, there are a lot of people that call themselves Christian, but they don't walk the compassionate path of the one they call Christ. So be very, very aware of this. And he said, you know, it really matters. Not what you're... It doesn't matter what you call yourself. It matters how you treat other people.
You've described your childhood as extreme, growing up in Maryland in the 60s. Your father was a minister, your mother, again, obviously part Native American but a Christian woman. Going to church was mandatory. What was that like?
Well, my father's mother was a missionary teacher and didn't believe in music or dancing unless it was somehow related to Christianity, particularly music. I mean, she was against really all forms of dancing. I can't dance anyway, so it didn't really affect me. But music was, a carrier of Satan and the devil. And so she and I never, ever got along. And yet she had five boys, one of them being my father, and she talked him into the ministry. He was going after the medical field. But so my mom thought she was marrying a pre-med student and then became a minister's wife. And so when he would go to church, she had worked in a record store as a teenager and she kept all her records. So she would play music for me when he would go.
What did your granny say, your father's mother, about getting married? What was her famous line about giving your body?
I need to remember that. You give your body to your husband and you give your soul to God. And I thought, and well, what's left? What do I get to keep, Grandma?
The piano, Tori. Your brother used to put telephone books under you so you could reach it at the age of how old?
Well, 2 and a half, my mother says, but that's when I started playing. Well, that one was, it was an upright and it was old and it was very tall and I couldn't reach it. So Papa and Nanny had a tiny little electric one, and I was able to reach that one because it was little. So my brother figured it out and would get phone books and plop me up there on top of the phone books, and he would play me things and make me play it back for him.
It didn't take long, though. At the age of 5, you won a full scholarship to the Peabody Institute and Johns Hopkins University, the youngest person ever to be admitted. How did your family feel about that?
Well, I think they were hopeful. I think my dad really hoped that I would follow the classical path and become a concert pianist. But it just didn't work out that way because I appreciated the classics and the first thing they did was, because I played everything by ear, they knew they had to teach me to read music. So therefore, they told everybody, don't play music for her because she can cheat. So therefore, everything she learns now must be from written music and her eyesight. And the problem with that, Sarah, is that I think when something is taken away from you like that, it's such a loss and such an incredible loss that...
It was your gift.
Yeah. So it was a bit of torture for the first 2 years. And finally, they realized once I could read that they would let me listen again. And so when I started to hear Mozart and Bach inventions being played, it was sort of like, a huge awakening.
Were you expelled for what Rolling Stone have called musical insubordination at the age of 11?
I tried to get them to understand that they needed to teach Beatles structure. I said, this is really, really important. I know a lot of the kids want to learn this. You're teaching how to analyze classical structure, but we really want to know about Beatles songs. And a professor said, why? Nobody's going to know who they are in 30 years' time. And I just said to them, they're the Mozart of their time. They are. And you're missing this. And they said, you're wrong. And this kind of attitude, young lady, isn't what we want. So I lost my scholarship. And I think it really affected my dad.
He was disappointed.
Devastated, yeah. Devastated. Yes. So in a couple years' time, he said to me, you're wasting your life. You're 13. And I kind of rolled my eyes and he said, we're going downtown. Your mom's away. So we're going downtown and you're going to get a job. I said, all right, let's go. And nobody would give us a chance. And so finally, the last place that we looked in Georgetown, the fact that he had a leather choker on should have been a giveaway. But, you know, we walked in anyway. And he said, this is my daughter and she can play. And he said, all right, let's see what she can do. And there, and the gay bar gave me a chance.
Did your dad give the gay bar a chance?
Well... He did, and then the church, they started to give him a real kind of, you know, backlash about it. And he said, well, the safest place for a teenage girl is in a gay bar. What are you people thinking?
The UK has always loved your music, Tori. Your first albums were big hits here, even before they were in the States. I cannot believe it's 25 years since Little Earthquakes. I was 18 years old when that came out, and I felt, as I'm sure a lot of girls did that were that age when it came out, like it was written for me. And then I saw you playing with your whole body, and I'd never seen anybody play the piano like that. I did piano to grade eight and never played again because of all the exam process, because I hated it so much, the pressure of it. And then when I saw you playing for the first time, I thought, damn, I wish I hadn't stopped playing. Oh, maybe there's still hope for me yet at 43. But when you look back at the girl who wrote Silent all these years and wrote Little Earthquakes, how different are you now?
I'm not that different. I'd come out of a terrible failure of a record in the late 80s. And
why can't Tori read?
Why can't Tori read, yeah. And so the treatment that I received from people in the music industry, it changed my life because I realized I had been in a disillusioned world. And that what really matters in the music business world is success. It's not necessarily the quality of your work as a musician. And I also realized that a lot of the great musicians do not survive the music business. The people in the music business are not necessarily the best musicians, Sarah. It takes a resilience. And you have to be, you have to be... A bad mamma jamma. How's that? That's not a bad word. And so in my failure and people that I thought my friends weren't my friends, there were very few people that were supportive at that time, I decided I was going to write music not for commercial purposes, but for expression. And so the five-year-old little girl in me kind of took my hand and said, I'm going to teach you how to do this, but you have to just write songs that are honest.
Well, it doesn't get more open and honest than this track. This is Silent All These Years from Little Earthquakes.
Excuse me, but can I be you for a while? My dog won't bite if you sit real still. I got the Antichrist in the kitchen yelling at me again. Yeah, I can hear. Been saved again by the garbage truck. I got something to say, you know, but nothing comes. Yes, I know what you think of me. You never shut up. Yeah, I can hear that. But what if I'm a mermaid in these jeans of hers with her name still on it? Hey, but I don't care, cause sometimes I said sometimes I hear my voice and it's been he.
Silent All These Years from Little Earthquakes, 25 years ago. That was the birth and very speedy heyday of grunge. There was Nirvana, there was Pearl Jam. God, even the Sugar Cubes had an album in the charts the month that Little Earthquakes came out. There was Britpop over here. Those were heady days.
Yes, they were. And, you know, I had to really fight to keep Little Earthquakes the way that that it is today. Because the people at the label felt that we needed to take all the pianos off and put guitars on. That's how alien this record was at the time.
How did you get to keep Me and a Gun, which is one of the most explicit songs ever written about rape? on that album?
It was, to be honest with you, it was the Brits who stood up for that. And they understood. There were people at East West Records that understood that it was an important song. And there were people in the States at the record label that didn't feel that that song should be on it because it was too harrowing for some of them.
You became an advocate for, well, I guess the American equivalent of Rape Crisis, the Rape, Abuse and Incest National Network. You were the first call to the launch of the hotline, and it's become a big, big part of your life. And if we fast forward to just a few years ago, Tori, you wrote a song for the documentary Audrey and Daisy, which is a shocking documentary, two girls, both victims of sexual assault and then of unbelievable social media bullying. What was that process like for you, and what did you learn, and how much did it bring back your own experience of rape?
Well, you know, I talked to the directors, John and Bonnie, and they're documentary filmmakers, and they had spent a lot of time in these two towns, very different towns. Audrey isn't with us anymore. She committed suicide after the social media bullying. I think that hearing the story of Audrey and Daisy and that it really happened put me in a place of, okay, there's a huge responsibility to try and tell their story, to talk about Daisy's resilience. Daisy and Delaney have been going to high schools and talking to high schoolers about the effects of sexual assault and social bullying on social media. And so Daisy and Delaney, their story has been very much Phoenix out of the ashes story. And so the song needed to acknowledge that.
It's a big responsibility. Your daughter, Tash, is 18 now, is that right?
She's 17.
She's 17, nearly 18. She sings with you on Up the Creek, which we heard earlier.
Yes.
She talks to you. That's one of your big achievements. You've said that you've got a good relationship, that she's open and honest and talks to you. What are your hopes and fears, though, knowing what you know about the world that young girls inhabit through doing that documentary?
Oh, what I couldn't wrap my head around is that this is particularly, I know more about the States than I do Britain, but this is happening all the time. On college campuses, yes, but also in high schools. And that's what the film showed me. And I talked on radio a lot about it in interviews about that we as grown-ups really are not aware that this is not just an epidemic, but it's endemic. And that it doesn't seem to be a discussion until lately. And that's why Daisy and Delaney going to high schools and talking to people their own age seems to have an effect. So the discussion's out there, but no, I had no idea, Sarah, how much of this is going on every weekend in the States. And you never think, oh, it's not going to happen in our community.
The wonderful Tori Amos, and that's actually a subject that we're going to be looking at here on Afternoon Edition in this country, that she was just referencing there. And Baking Good on Twitter says, had forgotten how wonderful Tori Amos is and how much I loved Little Earthquakes and Under the Pink. Lovely to hear her on Five Live. Ian says, I had the huge privilege of playing with some friends on Black Dyke Band and two tracks from Boys for Pele. That's one of Tori's albums. Tori was so welcoming and generous. She's a truly wonderful and unique musician. Thanks for the